IAB placement ads that you see proliferated over the digital channel. And then programmatic has come along, and so far all that's done is eviscerate yield for publishers. Add to that mobile, which actually makes it even worse in the context of a smaller screen size and less real estate for a marketer to be able to get across their message. So enter native advertising and content marketing. What are we talking about? Well, I say enter, but it's really not new. We've seen sponsored content exist almost from the earliest days of media and advertising. But I think what we're seeing lately is a resurgence of this, a sort of second coming, if you will, of content marketing. The question is the hype more than the reality? There's a lot of issues to get through, and we have a terrific panel of premium publishers that we're going to go through these issues with today and have this conversation. So let's do that now. I would like to introduce, we have from Andrew Creighton, is the president of Vice Media. Vice Media, as you may know, is the absolute darling of the media world, with almost every major traditional publisher seeking a stake in it. They most recently did a $250 million investment at a $3 billion valuation.
Look at his hand. $500 million.
Two $250 million investments for a $3 billion valuation. But you know, that was last week. It could be $5 billion this week. I don't know. It just keeps going going up. We've got Jimmy Maimon, president of Huffington Post. There we go. We got some HuffPoers in the room. And obviously, you well know Huffington Post, one of the pioneers of digital advertising, and in particular, leveraging content marketing. Heck, they've got unpaid contributors. So that's another unique model, a HuffPo. And to give you a German flavor to this topic, we've got Stan Sugarman, who's the chief sales and chief digital officer of Gruner & Jahr. So let's get into it, gents. So, you know, I hate definitional questions or, you know, starting off with sort of talking about what does it mean about native advertising and content marketing or any definition, but it is a mixed up kind of area and people can have different perspectives. I think of it as non-traditional, paid advertising in the traditional sense. But what I'd like to hear from each of you is, what does content marketing mean on your platform, whether it's formats or business models? Andrew.
Well, for me, when you look at the breakdown of our revenue, only 20% of our revenue is driven by straight digital ads, what would standard IAB units. And even within those units, we're doing special things within them now. So everything's becoming more bespoke to get rid of that banner blindness. But we work with brands in a different way. We have done for many, many years. We want to create culture and create IP that's relevant and has value and has meaning for our consumer if we're going to put it out in our channels. And that's what we've been lucky enough and managed to do on a multitude of different levels, whether it's a series, a one-off documentary, a whole platform, platform within a platform. We have a number of different methods of getting brands' messages out in a way that the consumers will accept and enjoy.
Yep. Jimmy, what is content marketing on a HuffPo platform?
On HuffPost is a number of things, obviously. It's everything from the listicle we already heard about to a brand post to a program that runs 24/7, 365 days a year with a lot of content. So almost like an always-on approach where advertisers work with us and have topics they want to cover in depth. An example of that is Johnson & Johnson that runs a program called Global Motherhood. They've now been running that for 3 years. They wanted to kind of raise awareness of what they do with Global Motherhood and associate that with their brands. And they're doing that with content, a lot of content. And we help them create that. We help them curate that experience. And it's something that fits very well with what we want to do with our site anyway. So it's not turning off the audience.
Yep.
So I'm the last one in the group. So content marketing for us is creating engagement using content. And so the traditional publisher, we don't have a lot of things maybe these guys have, but we have a hell of a lot of content. So how do you create content with partners and distribute that content to get a deeper dive? And I think Grunagnat does a great job of more of $100 million businesses in Europe just doing that type of content marketing.
Right, okay. You know, content marketing has taken some knocks. Some of the criticism of it relates to the notion of what's the value proposition and are these brands really just sort of, you know, driving this, you know, down our throats? And I suppose the real question would come around this notion of quality. You know, is the content that you're seeing, Jimmy, you've got traditional advertising juxtaposed with sponsored content, juxtaposed with sort of natural content or editorial content. Do you see differences in terms of engagement between, you know, the sort of normal course content creation versus sponsored content?
Of course there's differences. You know, things we do editorially has a different engagement levels. But I will say when we get it right, and also when we work with the brands and advertisers on making sure that the brand purposes they want to articulate when you move out into the native space. So really, you know, what we're talking about here is when you kind of move out of the right-hand rail and move into the content section. As soon as you get into the content section, I think it becomes extremely important kind of what it is you want to do as a publisher and also how you want to work with your advertisers, because the brand in many ways need to take the back seat. It can't be all about the product when you move out into the content section. Right. If that's what you're doing, then very fast you're going to turn off your audience. And obviously we're in the business of creating the biggest possible audience for Huffington Post, so that would, you know, defeat that purpose. So obviously we need to work with brands and making sure the brand purposes that they want to articulate are things that actually resonate well with our audience and things that we would have covered anyway. As I said before, Global Motherhood, one example, we work with Chipotle on Food for Thought. You know, those are topics where you go into, you know, deep issues and cover it in depth. And actually, it resonates very well with our audience. You know, engagement levels are not at the same as our editorial content, but very close to our editorial content. And that often becomes the way we see whether we've done this right. Because if we are not able to get that, then we've put stuff on our platform that over time will hurt us. And obviously, that's not the business we're in either. We need to monetize our audience, but in a responsible way.
Yep. But it almost feels to me like, you know, if it's sort of done the wrong way, you kind of know it right away, right? You see it and you're like, that doesn't feel right.
You do. You know, editorially, you have an editorial strategy, you know, for the editorial part of the side, but also on the business side, obviously, you need, there are things you want to do and there are things you don't want to do. And to your point, you know that, and you will have to be quite honest with the advertisers about, you know, this is a route we don't want to do, go down, and we have to do that. We do that on a weekly basis when we have proposals where we feel this is not right for HuffPost. And obviously, it's tough to say no to advertising dollars, but at the same time, you have to think about the long-term business.
Okay, so Jimmy just brings up this concept of the conflict between, or the potential conflict between, you know, editorial and business if you've got marketers that want to spend money to get their content across. And I got to say, there's been a lot of discussion about this particular issue at conferences and in boardrooms all across the world, but probably it takes a comedian to bring that issue to the fore in a really concise way. And I just want to show you, there is a, I have three words to say about this topic. Repurposed bovine waste. That was the phrase utilized by John Oliver when describing the potential conflict between church and state of native advertising. Here he is in a clip that he recently went on a rant on his comedy show. If you haven't seen it, this is fantastic stuff. Watch the whole thing. But here's an interesting clip, and I want to get into it.
Native advertising, though, has been so lucrative for new media organizations, they've basically built their entire business model around it. You might think all of this might seriously damage trust in a news organization, but a Times advertising executive would like to vigorously refute that.
Let me start by vigorously refuting the notion that native advertising has to erode consumer trust or compromise the wall that exists between editorial and advertising. Good native advertising is just not meant to be trickery. It's meant to be publishers sharing its storytelling tools with a marketer.
Exactly. Exactly. It's not trickery. It's sharing storytelling tools. And that's not bullshit. It's repurposed bovine waste. And look, in news.
So that gets a lot of laughs, right? But the reality is he's actually pointing out a real issue here. And that is the potential conflict between editorial and commercial if, in fact, your marketer, your advertiser partners are coming to the table with content that maybe doesn't sit well with the publisher's brand. And I want to just ask, because, Andrew, you mentioned this issue. How do you deal with this issue when a marketer wants to spend money on content in a manner that just doesn't sit well with your brand?
Yeah, I mean, the one thing that we do, which is probably unusual, is we make absolutely everything that goes on our site. So everything we put out on our site is 100% original.
So it's a control issue.
It's a control issue, and we will just say no. We just won't put it in the editorial stream. We can create advertising units that sit in an advertising unit, but we won't do it in the content stream. But saying that, like, I think it's important to note that, you know, the content creators and creative people, the creative class, have a funding gap to want the ideas they want to make.
Right.
And so brands have kind of a fundamental role to play in that because they have the excess money and they want to attach to content. So there's a need state on both parties to put together. And you've just got to have somebody who can matchmake in the middle in the right way and put the right ideas with the right people.
Yep.
That's right for the brand and their ideals and right for the creator and their ideas. And if you put those things together in the right way, then you can create value for the audience. And so you just need a good matchmaker. And that's kind of what Vice is. We match our ideas well and match our community well to the brands in the right way, that
yep.
everyone wins. So if everyone wins, then it's good. It has to be a three-way win. It has to be a win for the brand, it has to be a win for the creator,
yep.
and it has to be a win for the audience, otherwise it doesn't work.
Stan, German publishers have not always been on the leading front of digital innovation, let's just say, no offense. Where do you stand on this? Because it is somewhat of a, it almost feels like very sort of American to be commercially creating content, purpose for brands. Where does Germany fall on that spectrum?
I mean, when I hear that, it's like, what have corporate publishers been doing the last 30 years? They have storytelling and they have marketing tools and they go to brands, or what have great creative agencies do? So, from that distinction, I don't think Germany's a laggard there at all. I think Germans have been able, from publishers to pure digital players, been able to scale that business. And more marketers, they have great content, these advertisers, they just don't know how to package it and tell their story. That's why a Lufthansa or a Swarovski or a Bulgari come to Gournagnon or Lamborghini in the last time. They go, listen, we have great stuff to talk. Can you please package this and do the storytelling, and you have editorial capacity to do this? And then it's our job to work with them. Like Andrew said, when we come time to distribute that content, well, then the brand and the editorial have the say. And we're not going to do anything to destroy our brand quality. So if it doesn't fit with our great big brands, then we're going to hurt them as well. So we'll have the discussion to go, what do you need to do to actually create value from both sides?
Yeah.
If I can add to that, I think that is the important point here, is that we all know, if we've worked in the publishing industry, editorials has been around for 30 years. It's nothing new here. It's just we're doing it in a digital context. And really what's happening here is, because of the pace of media, because of social media, the pace of kind of what happens out there, it has increased tremendously. As an example, over the last 5 years, we've gone from publishing 200 stories to publishing 1,600 stories. That's us as a publisher. But if you're a brand today and you want to be relevant, you know, you need to publish a lot more. You need a lot more content out there. And that's where we think, and I think the industry thinks, you know, we obviously have a lot of learnings. We have a lot of data. We have a lot of tools that we have used that we can now kind of move over to the business sides,
yep.
have people working with brands, help them get into this space, help them to understand what it takes actually to re-engage with that audience, to have enough content out there to be relevant and to spark conversations. Because I think many brands today, that is where they struggle, is kind of the engagement part. How do we yep. re-engage with that digital audience? And that's obviously what we do day in, day out.
And how do you gauge success? Like, how do you gauge if consumers are either engaging with the brand content or kind of annoyed by it? Is it traditional click-through kind of engagement metrics?
We're here in Germany, so we're in the land of engineers. We talked about this. And if you can't measure it, then yeah. probably you have a problem. And because a lot of the stuff with content, and you're in the early days, you can't measure. So what do big publishers do? They have huge market research organizations
yep.
to basically talk to hundreds and thousands of people to say what's happening. And I know we just brought out a huge thing about native advertising do's and don'ts, and based on German engineering market research. So
right.
take a look at that. I think that it gives a lot of insights and a lot of measurement tools what you can do.
Right, right. In terms of... Andrew, you mentioned you create all of your own content for content marketing purposes, which sort of breeds a real question of this sort of blurring of lines between you're a publisher, but it sounds like that you're doing agency work on behalf of marketers. Where does that, are we talking about a blurring of lines? And then, Jimmy, are you guys making your own stuff as well, like Red Bull is?
Ultimately, there's a blurring of lines commercially, because you know what we do with our key brand partners is we go up the value chain. So we put as much care and attention into every bit of content that we make that we're going to go out into our platform with, and that's a development process, it's a production process, it's a distribution process, an activation process, and we charge the advertiser and the brand partner for all of those things.
Yep.
We don't just charge for the end product and the distribution
right.
at the end.
Okay.
Because that's how we make our CPMs work and make quality content and make long-form video and make those things cost more money than a video ad will pay for.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's how you get a $3 billion valuation. Charge them early, charge them often. Okay, keep going.
Yeah, so we charge for that because it's a big process, and it's not automated, and there's no shortcut to making great stuff. We have to put the care and attention into it, otherwise it won't be good enough. And to your point about having stuff that has different metrics, we want that stuff actually, in a way, should perform better in some ways, because
yep.
ordinarily they'll have some media support around it, actually pointing to it as well as the quality of the content. So,
right.
and sometimes we have that. We just did a big thing with the Planet of the Apes movie, where we went to Monrovia and found the real Planet of the Apes, and it was a fantastic documentary. Got tens of millions of views. Everyone liked it. It was 96% approval rating. It worked incredibly well as a fantastic piece of content, but with a wrapped marketing around it, and
so this is promotional budgets to enhance the impact of content marketing.
Yeah. So, you know, if the piece of content is great, then the advertiser has the power to activate that piece of content. So
yep.
you're actually going to get more views sometimes on some brand content initiatives than you do on other things. And you know, for us, like, we don't even use the word brand content in our building or
okay.
native advertising.
Right.
We try and do content that's on brand.
Right.
And then create a suite of assets around that that are more advertising focused, so you can keep the purity in the video itself.
And how much of the content, Jimmy, is HuffPo creating in-house versus in cooperation with agencies or marketers?
I think right now it's still, for native and content marketing, it's still early days, even
yep.
in the US. So there's not a lot of advertisers that has the in-house capabilities to actually pull it off. So at this point in time, a lot of the things that we produce are produced in-house. We have something we call HuffPost Partner Studio, because to answer your question, we actually believe that it's very important to still keep state and church. Just because media is evolving doesn't mean that you shouldn't keep your editorial integrity. And obviously the 700 journalists out of the 1,000 people we have, the 700 journalists that we have are not touching, they're not touching any of the stuff we're doing commercially. We have
okay.
a special team that are doing that. They have a lot of the same tools they can work with, but
right.
it's we've hired journalists on the business side that are working with advertisers and brands to help them, you know, bring their content to life in this new native and content marketing space. And I think from our perspective, that is key, that we don't kind of start to have two blurred lines, because then I think eventually we will fall off a cliff, because our audience will feel that we're you know, pushing things to them that they actually didn't sign up for, that they didn't come to Huffington Post for. So I think from our perspective, that is key.
Yep, yep. You know, we got onto this issue of if you're creating your own content or in part, it does bring up the issue of business model and scalability or leverage to the model, because of course, traditional paid advertising is an industrial process, and there's a lot of scalability to it. I think the whole question as to whether one has to, you know, Andrew, you said the word bespoke. If you have to create bespoke content for every campaign or every effort that these folks are doing, question whether we can actually bring scale to it. We did a Lumascape. Our content marketing native Lumascape was an attempt to capture some of the major players across all the different parts of the ecosystem, whether it's content creation, curation, distribution on third-party platforms. You've heard of some of these companies. This is basically venture capital's answer to whether you can scale content marketing by funding many of the companies that are bringing technology to the marketplace, including marketplaces. So there are now exchanges for native advertising. There's content marketing exchanges. And of course, let's not forget the social media.